Hi, Sharon.
Hi, Liz.
Your team at Goldman Sachs Research just published a new report, Womenomics, Europe Moving Ahead. What were you exploring in this research?
We're looking at the representation and progress of women in the workforce overall, in terms of pay gaps with men. Also at company level, we're looking at representation on boards and at different levels for women. I'm also looking to see how much progress has been made. And although the main focus of the report is on Europe, I'm also comparing with the US and Japan.
And what did your research find about female labor force participation in recent years, both in Europe and the US?
So when we talk about female labor force participation, we mean the percentage of women that are in the workforce. And in the US, unfortunately, that ratio has stagnated in recent years. There was lots of gains 20 or 30 years ago, but not so much recently. Now, Europe has typically lagged behind the US. Generally, fewer women used to work in Europe than they did in the US. But that's not so much true anymore. Indeed, Europe has caught up and in many cases overtaken the US in recent years. If we take all age bands from age 30 to age 59, then female participation in the labor force in Europe is now higher than it is in the US.
And what's driving those trends?
I think there are many factors. So it's kind of difficult to work out exactly what is driving it. I think one thing is women in their 50s and 60s who are working and staying in the workforce for longer than women in those cohorts did a generation ago. This is in fact a bigger driver in some ways than the younger women participating more in the workforce. And that's been a large change in Europe, I would say, in the last couple of decades. Another big factor is childcare. Childcare cost, childcare availability, childcare quality, also parental leave policies as well. These tend to be more generous in Europe. And they generally improved. They've still got more room for improvement. They've generally improved in the last decade or so. And there's a very good correlation between female labor force participation and those types of factors.
And what about the gender pay gap, which your research shows has narrowed significantly in Europe in recent years compared to the US? What are the factors behind that?
Yeah, I mean, this is a big focus of everybody, particularly the media and investors. And yes, it's another case, actually, of Europe doing better than the US. The gender pay gap is smaller in all major European countries than it is in the US, and far smaller than it is in Japan. Also, it's been coming down in recent years in Europe. It's been narrowing, whereas the difference between pay between men and women has really stagnated in the US. You haven't seen women catching up in the same way. That said, it's not all positive news. The pay gap is still large in most European countries. I would say, you know, it's still about 12 to 18%. Women are paid less than men. So there is still a lot more work to do. And of course, you could argue, well, women are not the same as men. As a group, they're not the same as say, men as a group. Women, for example, are more likely to work in particular industries. Maybe those are industries that pay less. And even within industries, women tend to do certain types of roles. So maybe those roles are paid less. Women have different tenure than men and different degree of work experience than men. So, and on average, they have slightly less work experience. So then does that justify this pay gap? I mean, we find even when we adjust for all those types of factors, you can only explain about a third to maybe up to a half of the pay gap. There's a large proportion which is totally unexplained by those observable factors. And that's true in Europe and in the US.
But to what extent do you think the persistent gender pay gap is attributable to a glass ceiling?
I think there is evidence of a glass ceiling, very much so. I had a look at UK data. There's lots of interesting UK data that shows pay gaps for different age groups, for example. And under 40s in full-time work, the pay gap for them have more or less disappeared. It's still slightly positive. So in other words, women are still paid a tiny bit less than men under 40, but really it's pretty close to zero now. And it's been close to zero for the past decade. So that's great news. But the pay gap is still pretty high for women in their 40s, 50s and 60s. And this is when women and men are reaching the highest pay potential in their careers. This is when they're going for the top echelons, and this is the point where the pay gap opens out the most. So, you know, I think that's very clear evidence of a kind of glass ceiling. And I do think this pay gap really matters because, and it should matter to younger women too, because they'll be aspiring to those roles in the future. So it's that pay gap that I think we haven't really broken, to use the analogy with the glass ceiling, and we need to over the next, the next few years.
Sharon, your research also highlights pretty significant progress when it comes to female representation on boards of directors, but less so in terms of women executives and managers. What's behind that?
Yeah, I mean, actually, the progress has been pretty phenomenal. I'd say very good in the case of Europe. So if you go back to 2005, only 9% of stock 600 board members were women. So that's the largest 600 listed companies in Europe. We had less than 10% of their board was made up of women. Whereas now it's around 31% of women board members for the stock 600 companies. So in less than a generation, you've seen a massive change, and that's great to see. I would say, though, it's flattened out in the last couple of years. I would also say that I suspect boards are very focused on targeting a level of around 30%, maybe a third. It's something that the media and investors are super focused on as well. And in some countries in Europe, there are even quotas to get a certain number of women on the board. So this becomes an ultra-targeted statistic. But the truth is, we need not just to target one level of representation. We need more women represented in the workforce, particularly in Europe, where it's declining working age population. That's also very much true in Japan as well, even more so in Japan, where there's a declining working age population. We need to encourage more female labor force participation. Also more women managers, so that layer below the board level, is that really coming through? That's seen improvements in the last 15 years, but nowhere near as much as that board level number. And then there are very few women CEOs and CFOs. That really, the needle has not moved there much in the last decade or two. So we've made some progress on certain statistics, and I would argue quite ultra-targeted statistics, but less progress on others.
And to what extent do you find that having women in senior positions as managers or on boards of directors correlates with the company's performance?
I mean, this is a good question and one we're often asked. I mean, I don't think it's the only way to justify having more diversity. Let's be clear, I think more diversity is a kind of moral imperative, a social imperative, and I think it's great to have more diversity, even if it doesn't necessarily mean more or less performance. What I do find, though, in Europe in the last decade, having a greater proportion of women on your board or as managers, that kind of next level down, has been associated with outperformance relative to your sector. So for the companies that have been in the top quartile for women on their board or women managers, it's led to about 2.5% annual outperformance relative to those in the bottom quartile. So that's an encouraging statistic, if you need an encouraging statistic, to go for a more diverse workforce.
Finally, Sharon, how has the pandemic affected Womenomics and gender equity in the workplace generally?
Look, I think this is a tricky one. And in some ways, the pandemic is so fresh, it's not over. We have yet to really see the full out in terms of bankruptcies, for example. In most of Europe, there have been furlough schemes or there have been short time work schemes. And these are insulated people's jobs. You haven't seen job losses to a large degree yet. So I think that's a pretty broad caveat. So it's really difficult to get a good handle on the impact. But relative to men, if I think of women as a group, are they going to lose out relative to men? I think there are positives and negatives for them relative to men. On the negative side, women definitely have taken on more of the childcare responsibility through the lockdowns, especially when schools and nurseries were not open for a long period of time. Secondly, some of the industries women work in have been hardest hit. Women, for example, are a large share of the workforce in travel and leisure and in retail. And as a very general point, women tend to work in more service-orientated roles or more service-orientated industries rather than in manufacturing. And services have been more hard hit by social distancing measures. So in all those senses, yes, I think women have been negatively impacted relative to men. But I think in other ways, less so. So there are more women that generally work in public services and in the public sector. Around 2/3 of public sector employees in the larger European countries are women. And these jobs are much more protected. Pay is rising, for example, in the public sector in the UK, and it's falling in the private sector. Also, lots of workers, both men and women, have needed to work more flexibly. And companies have had to allow that flexibility, we are now working more from home or more flexibly generally. And I think that should benefit all workers, but I think it should benefit women especially.
Thanks, Sharon.
Thanks very much, Liz.